Today we're going to talk about integration. Now coming to us in exciting 3D action. In other words, we're going to talk about triple integrals. And we'll see, okay, what's the philosophy? Spoiler alert, same ideas. Break things into part, work on each part, add them together, and life is good. Where's the challenge? Well, the real challenge is going to be the geometry, the describing of the regions over which you're integrating. So this is a wonderful chance for us to practice our 3D intuition. Well, for now, let's begin. So we know about integration, and really the philosophy for integration is let's find totals. So there's one-dimensional integration where we integrate over an interval. Okay, and that's where we started with. Integral over some integral, usually from a to b, f of x dx. I said, look, two dimensions, we can do that. And we've gotten pretty good at that, right? So we integrate over some region, some function, dA. Now, of course, what does this dx mean? Well, the dx is like a small piece of the interval. dA, it's a small piece of the region. There's our little dA. So when we go up to triple integration, it's going to be an integration over a three-dimensional region, we can think of it as a solid, f of xyz dv. So we have this dv. All right, well, that's just a little tiny piece of the volume. All right, so you have that little tiny piece, and there we go. So our idea in all cases when we talk about integration, it's always the same. Break what we're looking for into small parts. Now, why do we do that? It always comes down to saying, the thing is that the function varies, but when we look at a small part, it doesn't vary much. And so we can really get a good handle on what's happening in the small parts. So we say, great, now we know the contribution from each small part, and we add them up. So when we talk about integration, it's adding up the individual results. Now, one thing we want to point out is notation. And you'll see, now, what do we have here? When we have a one-dimensional integral, one integral sign. A two-dimensional integral, two integral signs. And a three-dimensional integral, three integral signs. So when you look at a problem, the notation tells you what kind of problem you're in. You can say, oh, am I in two dimensions? Am I in three dimensions? Am I in one dimension? So there's a lot of information stored in notation. Good notation should be informative and illuminate a problem. Bad notation is obfuscating and confuses what's going on. All right, so that's the idea. Let's get into a little bit more detail. How do we actually do it? So the way we're gonna really get into it is, since we're working for now in our Cartesian coordinate system, what we'll do is we'll chop things up into little cubes. Now, why does Cartesian say little cubes? We think of our variables as our x, y, and z. And so when we think about what happens if we perturb the x, y, and z. So perturbing x gives us sort of a movement in one direction. Perturbing y gives us a movement in another perpendicular direction. And perturbing z gives us movement in a third direction. Which means that the shape that forms when we perturb our variables here is a nice little box. And we say, all right, that's what we should chop our shape up into what's described by our variables. So you can say, all right, our volume of our shape, okay, length, width, height, delta x, delta y, delta z. So what's our total? Well, we're going to sum, and it'll be a triple sum. Now, why a triple sum? Well, because we have sort of three directions we play with. There's lots of little tiny cubes all together. We say, okay, well, how are we going in this direction? Then we index in that direction, then we index up in this direction. So for each direction, there's another sum. Then there's the function, all right? And of course, that depends on which one we're at. Oop, little typo here. That should be a J. Sorry, we'll fix that in post-production. And times delta V. And what does it go to? Well, of course, we chop things into smaller, smaller parts. That's our idea. And in the limit, we say, look, this is the integral. So the integral, of course, indicates adding things up. the function, which matches what's here, and the small bit of volume. All right, so that's the idea in practice. You know, as the saying goes, when the rubber hits the road, what do we actually do? Well, what we do is what we've done before, which is to slice. And we'll slice and look at what's happening. So, as an example, I can say, look, suppose I take my shape and I slice at a particular height. Now, I don't have to slice perpendicular to Z, but I can. There's really a choice. You can slice perpendicular to any direction that's convenient. So, suppose we did. So here, if we slice perpendicular to Z, in other words, perpendicular to the Z-axis, well, what you see is that this becomes a nice little picture in the XY plane. And so, I can say, oh, if here I think of this as Z equals K, then I say, okay, now I have a region and I have a function f of x, y, k. So it reduces it down to a previous problem. In other words, I'm now back to two dimensions. And I say, well, fantastic. I know how to do two-dimensional problems. We have this iterated integration. So, idea. Our integral over our solid, of our function dv, will be from lower bound to upper bound, whatever they happen to be. The contribution from that slice, in other words, what's the contribution that we get from here, times dz. Well, to get this contribution, what we're doing is the two-dimensional integral. So, okay, well, that's on the inside. It's a two-dimensional integral, and I can integrate dx dy or dy dx any order I want. So, there we go. There we go. And that's the idea. So it turns out that the way we're going to do triple integrals is essentially the same idea. Iteration. Integrate one variable at a time. So what's the tough part? The tough part are the bounds. Oh, that's going to be where we need to put in the most amount of work. Now there's some pretty easy cases. In two dimensions, we saw rectangles were great. Now in three dimensions, what's great are boxes. Boxes are wonderful to work with because they have a very elegant and simple description. But of course, we don't have to limit ourselves to boxes. We can do so much more. And so, what do we want to keep in mind? Well, when we look at our bounds, it's important to understand what's going on. So if I have a triple integral, all right, let's just work through it. So I have an integral, 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 and I have a function, f of x, y, z, and then I have a way to choose. Now, when we did two-dimensional, we had dx, dy, or dy, dx, right? We had two possibilities. When we have three, well, there's three different things we can rearrange. It turns out there's six different possibilities. Dx, dy, dz, dx, dz, dy, dy, dx, dz, dy, dz, dx, dz, dx, dy, and dz, dy, dx. Now, you might notice this one is boxed. All of them are perfectly fine. There's really nothing that says from a theoretical perspective that one is better than the other. From a problem perspective, certain problems will work better depending upon what technique you're doing. Or in other words, when I say what technique, what order of integration you're doing, some shapes have better descriptions. So ultimately it comes down to how do you describe the shape in the simplest form. And the best way to see this is with practice, and we'll get to practice in a different time. But if there's no other outside external thing suggesting what to do, I recommend starting in dz, dy, dx. And let's see why. If you think about what's happening, well, what you'll see is that the outermost integral goes with the outermost d whatever. So in this case, it would be the dx. So what happens? So here we say, okay, the bounds are numbers. So in other words, And the outermost integral is going to be from number to number. All right. Now, push in one. Okay. So now we're to the next level. So remember, we're going to talk about this. This is really x equals to x equals. Now, the next level in, we're going to have associated with y. So it's going to be a y equals something to y equals something. Now, what is that? The outside is numbers. Go in one level. And here, what we see is that the bounds are curves. That's what they are. So we're going between from one curve to another curve. This is what we saw in two dimensions. Okay, well, gotta push in one more time. And if we do that, what's gonna happen? Well, of course, the inside is gonna go with the inside. So this will be associated with the z. And what's that? What are the bounds? The bounds are surfaces. So in other words, on the innermost layer, you go from one surface to another surface. Now, why do I encourage you to consider using the order dz, dy, dx? Because when we think about our intuition, how we built up, we start off thinking, okay, number line x going between two numbers. When we go into two dimensions, we like to think, oh, y goes between two curves. And when we go into three dimensions, we like to think, oh, z, and in terms of z equals as our surfaces. So in terms of the way that we're used to thinking, it's most compatible. So that's why I recommend working in that order. But it's also just important to remember what things are. So for example, if I'm figuring out what the bounds are for, say, the innermost layer, I say, look here, d what? Well, in this case, z, could be x, could be y. And I say, all right, whatever it is, it's z equals, right? If this was x, x equals to x equals. And remember, you're looking for surfaces. So numbers, curves, surfaces. It's good to keep in mind what it is you're looking for. Now, the big challenge, the fun challenge. How do you change the order of integration? Which is also connected, how do you set up the integration? All right, so here's the process. And if you think back to when we talked about changing order of integration in two dimensions, it's gonna feel really, really familiar. So the first step, identify the current bounds. If you have it given as an integral already, the bounds are determined by what's here. That gives you the bounds. It might also say, oh, there's these bounding surfaces, and then you have to be a little bit more careful, but that's the place we start. Now, draw a picture. That's not so easy, but the kind of problems that we're going to consider, they're going to be very simple curves, things like planes or what we might call cylinders. If you remember what a cylinder is, well, of course, we oftentimes think of the cylinder as like a circle cupped up and down. But we also said, oh, a cylinder is a curve that really becomes a surface by copying it, right? So if you take a circle and copy it, the circle is the curve, copying it becomes the cylinder. And so it was something where there was like a missing variable. So missing variable, so like z is a function of y. If there's no x, okay, you get to copy in the x direction, and so forth and so on. So you'll have relatively easy things to work with. And all right, now, once you have your picture, make sure everything's labeled. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, we may have, z here is a function of x and y. Well, maybe we need to rearrange it, solve for x as a function of y and z, or maybe y is a function of x and z. Just make sure everything's labeled. And now, work on the bounds. All right, well, how do you do it? Now, there's different people like to do it in different ways. I like to say, work from the outside in. All right, set your outermost bounds, your innermost bounds. You know, I guess I should say outermost, middlest, and innermost. And keep in mind a couple of things to be aware of. you might have to split up your integral into multiple parts. When do you have to split up your integral into multiple parts? Well, focus on the inside, which is the surfaces, and ask yourself the question, do I have a consistent set of surfaces? In other words, maybe a consistent top and bottom surface, if you're integrating where dz is on the inside. Or maybe it's a consistent, you know, front and back surface if you're integrating with respect to x, or a consistent left and right surface if you're integrating with respect to y. If for some reason your surface changes at some point, either on one side or the other, that's where you have to split. But let's assume you have consistent bounding surfaces. Then it's just one integral. And now, you say, okay, figure out your outside, your middle, your inner. Now, do it one at a time. Don't try to do everything simultaneously. And what I strongly recommend is to use the following. There's this tip. To simplify the process, look down an axis to reduce the dimension. What does that mean? Well, one way to think of it is you can imagine, for instance, you have this three-dimensional shape. We'll do something very simple. Let's say it's a tetrahedron. Okay, so a tetrahedron, yeah, it might look something like this, okay, where we have the origin, we have these pieces here. And now what we can do is say, well, let's suppose it's dz dy dx, which says the z is the last thing I want to set. Well, what we can do is we can imagine that we grab onto that z-axis and we pull it. So we're going to take that z-axis and pull it to the point where we're looking straight down. See, we see the z-axis, but if we change our perspective, the z-axis becomes a single point. It really becomes essentially the origin. So that looking from above, okay, so from above, which means I'm looking straight down the z-axis, then now what I see is I don't see really a three-dimensional thing. What I see is a two-dimensional thing. And in particular, we see, this would look something like a triangle from above. And now I say, great. Now it's like setting up the bounds in a two-dimensional problem, which we're comfortable with. So that makes it easy for us to set up the x and the y bounds. And then when we say, okay, for the z bounds, how do you do that? Well, of course, go back to your three-dimensional picture and say, look, I have to go from z equals something to z equals something. So think of the surfaces that are bounding below and above. You say, well, there's a surface on the bottom side. Okay, that would be the part that goes into there, whatever z equals. And then there's the surface that's the top side. In this case, it looks like the slanted face of the tetrahedron, and that would go into there. And now you've got your bounds. Now this is best illustrated by examples. Try to do lots of examples. And the first couple will feel a bit unnatural. I'm going to be honest with you. I think setting up bounds for triple integrals, it's challenging at first. But once you start to develop that geometrical intuition, how do things work in three dimensions, it can actually be kind of fun. Because you're saying, what is my picture? All right, what are my surfaces? Okay, what do I need to do? Let's start working one layer at a time. And of course, when we think of working layers at a time, this means that this is an onion problem in calculus. Why? Well, onions have layers. And also, there might be a couple of tears involved by the time we hit the end. Well, time for us to go do some practice. Hope to see you soon.